This is Mark Bell from Super Training Gym. Super Training Gym, the strongest gym in the West, and today we're going to do a Q&A. I got a couple of questions that have come through on my YouTube channel, so going to get to it right now. This one comes from Jackie Lawson. I believe that's how you say her name, and she's saying, what are your thoughts on extended fasting? How often should I extend the fast? So I think, you know, I talk quite a bit about fasting on here, and I guess I should probably clarify when I say fasting that I should say intermittent fasting. I might have a slightly different view or different interpretation of fasting than most. My thing with fasting, I keep it really simple. If you're not eating, then you're fasting. So I think that you can fast for all different kinds of amount of time. I think that you can fast for 5 hours, 8 hours. I think they can all be very effective. They're going to have slightly different impact, and they're going to elicit different responses, obviously. I don't think that you have to like adhere to, I'm going to fast for 16 hours a day, or I'm going to fast for 20 hours a day. However, I think it's nice to have a goal. When you have a goal and you kind of treat life like a game, you tend to play the game a little bit better. So it might be a great idea for some of you to, if you're going to implement some fasting, to implement intermittent fasting and to set a goal, hey, I'm going to eat around this time each day. What I suggest, more so than thinking about intermittent fasting, it might be just easier to come from the other side of things and think about intermittently eating. Because really, that's all you're trying to do. You're trying just to eat two or three times a day. And that sounds a lot nicer than trying not to eat, right? It sounds a lot nicer when you say, I'm gonna try to eat two or three times a day, rather than say, I'm gonna fast for 20 hours. Sounds like a lot of hours to fast, right? To answer this question a little bit more in depth and to get into extended fasting, for me, extended fasting would be any time that you fast more than a day. You know, how often can you do these types of fasts? I think you can do a fast like that every week. I think once a week you can fast for 24 hours. I have a few friends, they fast every single Saturday or every single Sunday, kind of depending on the week and depending on what's in front of them. I think it's a great way to manage calories, just to have a day where you just don't eat. For me, if I was to try something like that, it would have to probably be more random than that. It would have to be on a day that's really, really busy. Because I have some days where when I get home from here, you know, from work, you know, where I trained and podcasted and recorded a bunch of YouTube videos, where I'm like, you know what, I could easily, like, I'm pretty tired. I could easily just, you know, end my day right here, drink some water and go to bed. So for me personally, it would have to be a day where I'm busier. I would think that with longer fasts, once you start getting into 48 and 72 hours and so on, we actually have a guy here at Super Training Gym that fasted for almost the entirety of the quarantine. He fasted for 40 days. When the time's right, when the time's appropriate, we'll get him to answer some questions so you guys can learn from him. But he lost 50 pounds during the quarantine. It was pretty wild. I mean, he literally looked like a completely different person. And we'll get some of the information from him on how he even handled that, how he managed that. One thing to keep in mind whenever you do any sort of fasting, I think it's a great idea to hydrate. So you want to have water, and you probably want to have salt. You may even want to have some electrolytes in general, beyond just salt. So you might want to look into getting a product called Element, which you can get off of Amazon, or you might want to look into getting a product called Keto Vitals until I come out with my own stuff, which will be soon, hopefully. If you're gonna do a 48-hour fast or 72-hour fast, I would recommend that you only do that like once a month, once every other month maybe. Just go by how you feel. I can't really tell you on how you're going to feel from doing that. Another thing to keep in mind, a few things to keep in mind with fasting. The number one rule of fasting is when you come out of a fast, you need to pretend that it never happened. And what I mean by that is that you don't want to like make up for lost time. You don't want to eat and eat and eat and eat, you know, stuff yourself and end up eating an abundance of calories, because the whole point normally for fasting is to manage your calories, right? Another thing that's important when you come out of a fast, especially a 48-hour, 72-hour fast, something that's really important but it's important coming out of all fasts, is you want to reintroduce the food slowly. And you want to have things that are going to digest well and things that are going to be easy for you to digest, things that aren't going to really hurt your stomach. And that is part of a learning process, you know, for each person. For me, a lot of times I'll go home and I almost always have some hard-boiled eggs. So I'll start with that. Eggs are pretty easy for me to digest. Maybe you find it a little different. Maybe you're allergic to eggs. I don't know. I'll usually mash them up. I throw some salt. I throw some garlic. I throw some pepper on them. Sometimes a little bit of olive oil. I only eat like 2 or 4 of those. And sometimes it's while I'm cooking. So that breaks my fast. You can also break your fast with some bone broth. Another key thing to keep in mind with fasting is we don't want to be fancy. You know, we never want to be fancy. We want to build consistency. And so is utilizing some fasting, how can you be consistent with that? And that's where you end up reverting back to something like intermittent fasting. Because intermittent fasting, it's reasonable to incorporate intermittent fasting into your life on a consistent basis, to do it frequently, right? But to frequently just not eat for many, many days and things like that just doesn't seem healthy and doesn't seem to make a lot of sense. So make sure that you're not getting too wrapped up in the weight loss, and make sure you're not getting too wrapped up in just the whole process. Lastly, I'll finish this part off, this question off with another thing I think is important when it comes to fasting, or maybe I should word it as just the overall management of calories and how to figure out how you can continue to lose weight but yet hold muscle mass and start to build the body that you want. You need to be protein minded, in my opinion. However you get your protein is going to be up to you. I've come to the realization, even though I am a carnivore and I love meat, I've come to the realization that diet is very personal, and you could have a bunch of different reasons on why you don't want to participate in eating meat. I don't know what those reasons are, but you're entitled to have your reasons, just as I'm entitled to eat meat, right? So I don't want to infringe or impede upon that. I just want to share with you guys some of my experiences, but I have come to learn that it's just not useful for me to say, no, you can't do that. You know, I'd rather encourage you to try these methods. And if you're going to implement some fasting, and you're vegan or vegetarian or you don't eat a lot of meat, I would still encourage you very strongly to figure out ways of getting in protein, and especially protein that you feel you digest and assimilate well. So that's that question. That's a question about some intermittent fasting. And let me see what else my boy Carlos sent over to me. This question comes from Jason Gleason, and he said he's been carnivore since April 23rd. Congratulations. Oh, this is kind of a personal question. Can I get a hey now? He said, I only poop about once a week. Should I take something or not be concerned? It's a great question. You know, we see this a lot. Something to understand is that whenever you change your nutrition, there's going to be a change in what happens in the bathroom. So let's just say that out of nowhere, I stopped drinking soda and I started to increase the amount of water that I drink. Well, I'm going to end up in the bathroom a lot. Let's say out of nowhere, I have been walking around with a gallon of water, you know, for the last few years because I was doing the bodybuilding thing and I was guzzling down tons of water. And then I did some research and recognized that's not a great idea. Well, if I discontinue doing that and I start to drink a lot less water, I'll end up in the bathroom a lot less, right? When we start to change our nutritional habits when it comes to the food that we're ingesting, you're going to end up noticing some big time differences. And sometimes it's almost always for the better. So it might sound kind of funny, but the urge to like take a dump, like in the middle of the day where it just, you know, hits you out of nowhere, I don't think that that's normal. I think that a lot of times that has to do with you not eating the right foods and the correct foods. I think that your poop should be somewhat on a schedule. It should kind of happen around the same time every day. It shouldn't be random. I also don't think each person's norm and each person's rate at which they use the bathroom is different. So each, you know, if somebody might go 2 or 3 times a day, somebody else might go once a day. But I would say that if you're using the bathroom frequently, I can almost always point to your nutrition being fairly flawed, where you're just not, something's not correct for you to eat, and you continue to consume it. And that could be a food allergy, or that could be the fact that you have a hard time staying on plan and staying on point, or you're just eating a lot of irritants and things that are just, they're just not agreeing with your stomach for whatever reason. But in this case, you know, we get asked this question a lot when it comes to the carnivore diet, like, oh man, I haven't, you know, haven't gone to the bathroom in a long time. As long as everything's normal when you're in the bathroom, as long as you know, you're not having excessive diarrhea, or as long as your poops don't hurt, as long as we're not getting super dry or something like that, then I don't think we have a real concern. I also don't think it's too concerning if when you switch your diet up that you experience some discomfort for a little bit. I think it's normal. I think it's to be expected. Especially, I think you always have to go, you have to always look at, like, where are you coming from? You know, what's your background? What was your history of eating? Start to look into some of that. The last thing on this note here is that oftentimes when people refer to using the bathroom a lot less, I don't think they're considering how much less food they're eating. So you might have implemented intermittent fasting and you might have started to eat more meat, and then you're thinking, oh, the carnivore diet's, you know, leaving me poopless, which may be true, but it also might just be true of the fact that you're just not eating the same amount. Those are all things to think about, all things to consider. Lastly, I know I said the other thing was going to be last. Lastly, I'll finish with, if you feel like throwing in some fiber, I don't think it's going to hurt anything. If you feel like throwing in a little bit of veggies or a little bit of this or a little bit of that. But remember, a lot of times when we're doing the carnivore diet, we're doing the carnivore diet a lot of times as a challenge, as an elimination diet, to kind of see what's going to be the effects of only eating meat. For me personally, I found the effects of only eating meat feels amazing. And it leaves me, from a conditioning standpoint, from the way that I look, it gives me the best look. And in addition to that, it helps me train in the gym. However, it's not convenient enough for me to only stick with eating just meat. And I maybe convenience isn't the right word. It's not like fun enough for me to do it. I feel like eating an apple. I feel like eating some vegetables here and there. I also have cravings just like anybody else. I feel like eating some ice cream. I feel like eating some pizza. I feel like having a sandwich here and there. I always like to just kind of call this whole entire journey, this whole project, if you will, being like meat-minded. You know, that's I like to eat meat. I centralize my nutrition around meat, but I'm also not afraid to throw in some other food. So that might be something that assists you, is to mix in some other food. We got one more question that we'll answer here. And this one is from the Green Machine. Green Machine Lawn Care. I love the way to plug your business here as we answer some questions here. This guy is asking about the paleo diet. He's saying, basically, do you think the paleo diet would be a great way to decrease carbohydrates but not eliminate them completely? Do you think it's a good diet for that? First, I'll just say the paleo diet's fantastic. The stuff, the information from Rob Wolf, if you haven't checked into some of the stuff that he talks about, he has a book called The Paleo Solution. He has a newer book called The Something Cow. I can't remember what it was or what it's called exactly. But this information from Rob Wolf, he has fantastic info and he has a lot of great insight into nutrition. But most of the time when I hear people talking about carnivore, I hear people talking about keto, everything always seems to circle back to our buddy Rob Wolf, who has come to this realization, and I've come to this similar realization, and so have a few others, that low-carb, ketogenic-style diets, carnivore-style diets are absolutely fantastic. But when you implement a little bit of carbohydrate into them here and there, you implement some fruit, you implement some vegetables, you have potatoes here and there, you have rice here and there. And what I'm saying here and there, I'm talking about probably under 100 grams of carbohydrates, even on a day where your exercise is pretty high, that you end up with some fantastic results. You get the best of both worlds. Now, this is just things I've observed, and I think a lot of it is stuff that Rob has observed as well. So it's not necessarily concrete scientific information. But remember, even scientific studies can be very flawed. I want to make it clear that there's no absolutes. Nothing is certain. We know some stuff about nutrition, but really, nutrition science is not nearly as far advanced as I think most people would like to think it is. But it's getting there, and it's important to have that research. It's important to have that information flowing. But sometimes I got to admit, where I get so frustrated with people citing studies and so forth, where I'm like, you know what? are we any better off having nutrition science at all? Could we take the entire thing and just throw it in the garbage and just eat the way that we were meant to eat? We don't only have those foods available to us. We have so many other foods. So I think it's important to get the research and get the message out there that excess food, processed foods, highly palatable foods, foods containing, you know, a lot of sugar and a lot of fat and salt and all these things kind of override our body's ability to know and learn when it's full and when we should stop eating. And because of that, we have diabetes, heart disease, cancer, Alzheimer's. I mean, it's crazy. Like I've said this 3 or 4 years ago, you know, how dementia and Alzheimer's and some of these things were highly connected to our foods. And people got really mad and really upset with me, but they are highly connected to our food. So if you know anybody that, you know, if grandma or so-and-so is, you know, losing their memory and cognition and stuff, I would highly recommend looking into a ketogenic diet. It might be something that could be helpful to them. And I said might be, right? So I don't know, but it could be. But do I think the paleo diet is a good idea? I think it's a great idea. I think it's, so I also want to say that when I started this entire journey from weighing 330 pounds, nowadays I usually weigh around 240, 235, 240. I've lost over 100 pounds. I got all the way down to 220 at one point. But I want to make it very clear that the entire thing started with a paleo diet from Rob Wolf. I think the book's called Paleo Solution or The Paleo Solution or something like that. That book was and is still revolutionary. That book is fantastic. And it's kind of funny to say that a paleo diet's revolutionary. As I mentioned earlier, did nutrition science help us do anything? It seems like it's just leading us in a big circle, but I guess you could say that about a lot of forms of science. Thank you guys so much for following along. And please, you know, I advocate strongly, ask questions. And this one, you can ask me anything that I answered here today or anything else that you want to ask. But if we kind of keep on topic and we keep with nutrition and poop, I think that would be a good place to start. Strength is never a weakness. Weakness is never strength. Catch y'all later.